me start our lecture by presenting this schedule. We are moving to week 8, and we will have the laboratory on May 26th, and the laboratory gonna be number 8. That is the bending of timber beam. And then week 9, we will have lab number 9, which is the bending of the steel and cast iron. And then when we move later to the June 9, that is going to be the week number 10, we are going to have the fatigue testing lab. PTA PAL is going to be the main TA for this laboratory. For lab 8 and lab 9, PTA 9 should be the main TA for the laboratory. And we will finish all the lab on the week 11, on the lab number 6 and number 7. I think that is the lab by P. Pongpanot. And then last week, the week 12, that is for you to clear up all the lab report. You guys supposed to check with P. Oriya and P. Kanjana whether you send all the lab report, every lab report to PTA. If you miss only one of the laboratory report, you will get the gate of I. And if PTA still didn't get your lab report, the I will change to the F. And then this last four labs laboratory is going to be the on-site laboratory. You guys supposed to prepare the ATK test result to present to PTA. If somehow you get sick or you are really risky person, PTA will allow you to out of the laboratory. So by doing that, we would consider you are missing the lab. But if you somehow just skip the lab, won't attend the lab, won't come to the lab, won't show the ATK, and you miss only one of this laboratory, you will get the I. And then if PTA consider you are not qualified for relab, I mean to repeat the lab, you will get the grade of F. Okay, that's all we have for the next four laboratory. And please, on the last week by June, I think that's supposed to be June the 23rd, you will get the result from PTA, which lab you are missing. And then let me go to the final examination. We will have an on-site final examination. And again, the lab, the examination will be the multiple choices examination. That's going to be like, I cannot remember, about 7 to 20 to 80 problem. And that's going to take about 2 hours. And there is no written examination for this multiple choice final examination. However, the schedule for the final examination, I will consider later whether it's going to be in the university schedule or out of the university schedule. Do you guys have any question about these two things, about the laboratory session and also for the final examination? that's going to be 25%. Okay, that means there is two examination, midterm and final examination for 50%. And the laboratory in the hand of TA, that is going to be another 50%. Okay? If no one asks me the question, let me move to chapter 5. Oh, I forgot. The final examination mainly will include chapter 5 and chapter 6. And still, chapter 1 to chapter 4 maybe appear on the final examination, but it's about like a 10% or not more than 15%. So concentrate on chapter 5 and chapter 6. And then, this is going to be the open book examination? No, for sure. This is going to be the on-site examination. Usually, we will allow A4 a page of A4 paper. You can take any note for just a page of the paper to the examination room. Some may write very small letters to get a lot of content, but beware about you cannot find it if that is too small. And you can put any color ink to making your A4 open paper. Okay, that's going to be all of that. Let me move to chapter 5. We did discuss about the tension test and the compression test from the week before the midterm examination. And for the rest of this lecture, we will be talking about the what's so called the shear test. And the shear test can be separated into the direct shear test and torsional shear test. And if you may recall, the torsional shear test is lab number 4. We have it since week 2 of this trimester. And we also have the direct shear test. One is the single shear test. Another one is the double shear test with P-foam. Okay, and then we will have the fractional test. For the fractional test, it will talk in laboratory number 8 for this week, and next week for laboratory number 9. And the last one for the fatigue test, that's going to be lab number 13. PTA Pao will be the main TA for this laboratory. Okay, by doing this, let me move you guys to this connection. By this connection, you may see the UHF connection. They connect to each other and then it transfer the force from the thyroid. Usually the thyroid is in tension. How to transfer the tension from the thyroid to this connection? We use, for example, the bow that link the thyroid with the U connection. And by doing this, if you take the U connection, just take the bow out, and then you may imagine the tension will take in this direction. And by the way, the U shape on the left and on the right will take the force. So by doing this, you may see this is the example. The shear will cut in this green section. And since the shear take half of the tension force, so by doing this, this is a kind of double shear. And then usually the bulb that's used to connect this connection is made by steel or aluminum, depending on the structure you are considering. And then let me go to the content of static shear test. Again, there is two types of shear test. One is direct shear test. The direct shear test, one is for the timber and one is for the metal. And you may recall which one going to be the single shear test. And another one is going to be the double shear test. And what kind of metal we use in the direct shear test of the metal? If you may recall, that's going to be brass, it's going to be copper, and it's going to be aluminum, okay? And another one that you have is the torsional shear test. You may put your finger like this, and then you twist it. This kind of shear test, we did test one for the steel, another one for the cast iron, and you should recall the way the material fell, the steel fell different from the cast iron. And for the direct shear again, there are two types of it. One for the metal is over here and is in the form of double shear. And please remember what kind of material we have for this direct double shear. And then another one, this is in the form of single shear. And you may assume from the picture that that is for the timber. And based upon what we have here for the direct shear test, the stress is going to be the shear divided by the area. Then when we consider the double shear, you may just consider only this portion of the material. And you can see this portion of material subjected to the shear force that's parallel to the surface of the material. If this one is P, so the shear force over here is going to be P over 2. Based upon this, we got this equation. If in the final examination, I said we have the P of 1 kilonewton and we have the diameter of this brass or copper or aluminum to be 5 millimeter. Can you compute the shear stress occur over here? So that's quite simple, right? It may take just like a 2 or 3 minutes for you guys to compute it. Okay, by doing this, you just take the tau is going to be 1,000 newton divided by 2. And then it's going to be pi and millimeter 2.5 square. And then you get this result in newton per square millimeter. And it's going to be in mega pascal. Now we move to the timber. And you may recall by using this kind of force is going to produce the shear that occur in the crack of this material. And then you may see there is the shear force. And now this shear force is going to be equal to the applied force. By doing this, the stress occur on this one will determine from this equation. That's very simple again. If Ajahn said this is going to be 10 kilonewton. And then we have the crack one side is L1 equal to 40 millimeter and another side L2 is going to be like 45 millimeter and then there is the depth okay that's time the depth maybe like 50 millimeter can you compute the stress occur during the crack of this timber you can okay that's maybe the second problem in the final examination Ajahn, do we use the torsion member in our civil engineering application we use a lot on the ball and pie especially for now if you are in the university you may see the ball and pie in the construction of our new dormitory you may come over there and ask the engineer to go to the construction sites there is the auger or you may cork it the dueler head that's used to dewel up the soil out of the ball and then you just after you take the ball pie in our university is the dye ball pie however in the Bangkok it's going to be the wet process it's different from what we have over here anyway the main concept is the same thing you dig the soil as a column and then you put the steel and cast the concrete into that pie to make it as the ball pie another way of using this torsional member is the auger we use auger to investigate the soil or rock layer during the construction of the elevated highway near the Khao Yai Thiang we have rock layer so the foundation for that elevated highway must be used the auger to taking care of the rock to drill the rock to make the pie for its foundation okay so that's for the example another example is may use the shaft in the mechanical part to transfer the torsion from the machine to some mechanical system and for that we can model the shaft to be something like this and in the test of the shaft we need to measure first the diameter of the shaft and then we also require to measure the length and based upon this if you just fix the line over here okay before the test after the test this line have twist to this one and based upon this what we have is the angle of twist that's move from this left right to this light blue and when you measure it you will see this one the angle over here as the angle of twist is occur due to the torsion key and then based upon this what you need to do is plot the shear strain and then shear strain diagram how do you compute it I may ask a lot of this question in the final examination the shear stress is going to be the torsion times the radius and divided by the polar moment of inertia the radius is simple the radius is just the diameter divided by 2 but how about this is going to be polar moment of inertia pi d power 4 divided by 32 if you use the diameter. But if you use the radius, that is going to be pi r power 4 divided by 2. And you may record this equation into your A4 paper, okay, if you cannot remember it. And also, how about this one? The tau supposed to be in mega pascal. How about the shear strain? The shear strain has the unit in radian. And then for the angle of the width phi, that you can measure in the lab. How can you compute for the shear strain? Again, basis upon this green displacement, we have this one at the phi. So this length, this green length, you may say it's going to be phi r. And also, if you refer this one back to the reference line, the angle change over here is going to be the gamma. This is in the radian. If gamma times the length L is going to be, again, the yellow displacement. So the shear strain can be computed by the angle of the width and times R divided by L. So this is maybe another two problems in the midterm examination. Now, when you consider this one, all of the equation, okay, will produce the stress strain diagram. And the first portion of the stress strain diagram usually linear, elastic, and then it will start to be nonlinear. Okay, by doing this, the slope of this stress strain diagram will follow what's so called the Hooke's law for shear. And then you have tau equal to G gamma. G is going to be the shear modulus of elasticity. It represents the stiffness of the material when it's subjected to the torsion. And also, you may determine the G by using G equal to modulus of elasticity divided by 1 plus Poisson ratio. So G can compute by the ratio of shear stress by divided by the shear strain, or you may compute the G follow the equation here. Okay, so this may be another three problem, and usually I didn't let ask all of these three question, but I hope you guys should be able to compute shear stress, shear strain, because you write the laboratory four report already. And then when you plot the graph again, the main one of very important point is going to be the tau sub y. And usually we may assume tau sub y equal to tau proportion. And then we also have the ultimate shear stress and the ultimate fracture stress. And when we have this one, the G, again, is going to be the slope of the linear elastic portion. You may use this graph to compute for the shear modulus of elasticity also. And the limitation of the test, there is a lot of limitation for the shear test. We start talking about the direct shear test. The direct shear test, as you may know, we can compute for the ultimate shear stress for the metal and ultimate shear stress for the timber. But the value that we calculate is just the approximate shear strength because there is at least three factors we got to beware about it. One, there is the eccentric of the shear force. Okay, that may cause some bending stress in the material when we shear the specimen in the timber. You may recall the free body diagram of the timber is like this. And then when you put the shear force onto it, and you can see there is the about the center line of the support over here, that is a small eccentricity that's caused the bending stress. And also there is the friction between the contact point when it's cracked. Okay, there is some friction occur over here. And also the stiffness and sharpness of the steel plate that we use to transfer the force. And second, it cannot provide all the mechanical property. I mean, we cannot plot the shear strain diagram from the direct shear test. We can plot by using the torsional shear test, okay? And then the torsional shear test also has the limitation because when we test the steel, okay, by the torsion, the failure of the steel in the shape like this, for the steel, the failure of the material is due to the shear stress. However, if you test for the cast iron, the crack of the specimen will be in the 45 degree, something crack like this. The crack that occurs in the cast iron is not due to the shear stress, it's due to the tensile stress. So the torsion test is not proper for the test of this kind of brittle material, okay? And these are the specimen for the lab 10. This is going to be brass, this is going to be copper, and this is going to be aluminum. We don't test the steel because there are some technical problems when we use the steel. It's going to be harmful to the testing machine. And then for the lab 11, we measure the dimension of the specimen, and also we compute for the volume of it. If you remember, we just weigh the specimen trying to find the density of the timber, and we trying to study if the timber have the higher density, it's supposed to have more timber grains, and the strength of that timber supposed to be higher than the timber that has low density. And come to the test, everybody is supposed to recall from this picture which one going to be lab number 10, which one going to be lab number 11. Now, for the torsion test, the specimen for the torsion test, we have this one for the steel and this one for the cast iron. Actually, for the ME student, they also test the brass in the torsion. The specimen for the torsion is supposed to be large enough in order to measure the shear strength properly. And also, is going to have large enough L to reduce the effect of stress concentration. So that is two important factors. Okay, and the third, that is the thin wall specimen with diameter with the ratio of what of the thickness. This is going to be the T and the diameter, the D over T supposed to be larger than or equal to 10 over 12. If you prefer to determine the proportional shear strength accurately. And then for the Dodi's lab, again, lab number 4, lab number 10, lab number 11. Please be aware of if I ask you the, for example, what kind of material we test in the laboratory number 4. Okay, you guys are supposed to be able to answer it. What kind of material do we, did we use in the laboratory number 10? Okay, that's kind of simple question. If you may recall it, but if not, you got to write down to the A4 paper. Okay, what kind of direct shear test for the laboratory number 10? It's supposed to be double shear, right? And for laboratory number 11, that is going to be single direct shear test. Okay, and then for the torsion again, if we test the ductile material such as the steel, this failure has the 90 degree perpendicular to the axis. If you have this one, and then you may again draw the model, and the failure occur in this direction. That means it's perpendicular to the longitudinal axis. And this one causes by torsional shear stress. In the different way of failure, we have the cast iron. And our cast iron, again, if you draw this one, this picture in the form of the model, the crack is like this. That is 45 degrees when you measure with respect to the longitudinal axis. This kind of crack is due to the tensile stress. So please remember the differences of them. Also, you got to understand if the steel is in tension, and you may recall during the tension test, there is the necking occur over here before the failure of the steel in tension. This one also fail by what? Shear stress. And again, if you have the cast iron and you test it in tension, the crack of this is in the form of perpendicular to the axis. And again, this kind of failure is due to the normal stress. And the reason behind it, can you tell me what the reason behind it? If not, go back to read the book again. Okay? This picture just show you guys how the ductile material fail. Ductile material fail due to the this one shear stress. And this one is the failure of the brittle material. That is due to the sigma. However, this one is due to the shear stress. Okay? And then the conclusion about the torsion test for the steel, okay, and this one for the cast iron, subjected to the torsion. And when you consider the tension, okay, the failure of the steel is like this. You can see due to the shear stress on both tests, but the crack have some different manner because the effect of forces are different. And this one failed by the normal stress. And again, the crack pattern just opposite to the steel. And you may remember the picture better than remember the table above. I recommend you guys. Next, let me move to the static bending test. That's going to be lab number 8 for the timber. That is, one is the short timber. Another one is going to be the long timber. And then we have lab number 9. And lab number 9 will talking about the steel and talking about the cast iron. And we will have only one length of specimen. And in our test, we will put the load at the mid-length of the specimen, L over 2. And this type of test is in the form of three-point loading test. By the three-point loading test, if this one is P, the force over here will be P over 2. And then when you increase the force P, what we have is going to be you increase the shear force and also you increase the maximum bending. And then at some point, there's supposed to be crack, okay, occur in the maximum moment. It may be due to tension or it may be compression. We will discuss this later. But based upon this test, we test for the steel. That means we're going to determine the fractional stress at the yielding point, or you find yielding stress based on bending test. However, if you test for the cast iron, the cast iron will fail different from the steel. As you know, cast iron is the brittle material. For the cast iron, we will find modulus of rupture. That is official name. And it is equivalent to sigma at its fracture. Or actually, this is not the modulus. It's going to be fracture stress. And another important property that we measure in this test is going to be fractional modulus of elasticity. Okay, we will talk about this later. Now, by doing this, please take a note that the bending test usually used to find the tensile strength of the cast iron or of the brittle material, since that material cannot test efficiently in tension because it's hard to grip the cast iron. Okay, and then for the three-point loading test, again, you can determine the force P has this, what this is going to be reaction. And again, based upon this, you may determine the shear stress based on the shear diagram. This is going to be P over 2. This is going to be minus P over 2. Also, the bending moment diagram of this beam is going to be something like this. And maximum moment occur over here. So, based upon this, Mmax is going to be what? is going to be the area of shear diagram since the beam divide by half because the load apply at the mid length or mid span of the specimen. So this one will be P over 2 times L over 2. That is going to be PL over 4. And basis upon this, can you determine the shear stress due to this moment? The shear stress is going to be M. And if the specimen has rectangular section, okay, you may what? You may think, depend on the position Y, that you are measure the stress that occur over here will change with the position Y. That is going to be MY. And then divided by what's so called the moment of inertia. If the specimen width is B and depth is H, so I is going to be BH cubed over 12. And the maximum stress for the rectangular section will occur over here, will occur when Y equal to H over 2. So you just plug this one by H over 2 and I over here, you can compute for the fractional normal stress. That may be the problem number 10 for the final examination. Can you compute it? And again, under the application of the force, one may assume pin over here. And under the force, you will have the deflection. And Vmax in this form can be compute from P L cube over 48 EI. You may go back to the mechanics of material, to the deflection table. You may see this maximum deflection occur over here. And at the point of maximum deflection, last lecture, we discussed about at this point, the slope is going to be zero. That's typical for the maximum or minimum of the curve. Okay, when you go to the maximum, the slope or the maximum always zero. Can you compute for the Vmax if Ajahn give you the value of P, the value of L, the value of modulus of elasticity, and the value of I? That's maybe another question in the final examination. Okay, the 3-point loading is easy to set up and is used in our laboratory to find the material properties. In the large scale tests of structural member, such as the test of the PCAS RC beam, such as the work by P. Chu Tong. In this test, we usually use the 4-point loading test for large scale tests. And why? I will tell you why. Under the application of the force, okay, the transfer beam usually will transfer the force half over here and half over here. And usually this one is going to be L divided by 3 to separate them into 3 equal sections. And based upon this, if you use your previous knowledge of engineering static, okay, you will get the reaction to be half of the applied force. Again, you will get the shear diagram in the form like this, which is different from the shear diagram of the three-point loading. And also, you will get this one plus P over 2 minus P over 2, the shear diagram in the shape like this. And the maximum moment will occur in this segment or this region. Unlike this one, the maximum occur at the point. So when you measure a large scale structural specimen, it's going to be, let us be able to consider a large portion of the structure. And what is going to be the Mmax? Mmax going to be P over 2. And this one times L over 3. So the Mmax occur in this region will PL over 6. Can you compute the maximum moment for this 4-point loading? That is going to be the extent for our knowledge. And also, what is going to be the maximum stress occur in this beam? Okay, that is account for at least 15 problems. Again, based upon the fractional normal stress equation, let me spell out again, the material must be in the linear elastic in order the stress distribution is in linear elastic, and the strain distribution will follow the stress distribution. Okay, this is our laboratory aid. You guys going to have the laboratory this Thursday. And then physical meaning of this, when you bend the specimen, that means actually you put the force into the middle of this, okay? And then there is the reaction occur over here, occur on this way. And the specimen will deform like this. The top in compression, the bottom is going to be in tension, okay? And you may see the change in the cross section. Theoretically, when the specimen is in compression, the width will get larger. And that means this one will get be larger. However, the one that's in tension going to get smaller. That's very theoretical. In reality, it's pretty hard to measure the change in the dimension of the section of the beam in bending test. And for a more simple imagine, just change it to the rubber, okay? And then you put it in compression. The rubber beam will have the contraction on the top and elongation on the bottom. And at the middle, there is no deformation. We call it neutral. And usually, this is the neutral axis of the section. And usually, it's also on the centroid of the section. Okay, going back to mechanics of material, chapter 6, we consider this picture before, based upon the linear elastic behavior under a pilot, the distribution of the strain, top picture, stress, bottom picture will be in the linear elastic manner. And we have the flexural formula, sigma equal to my over I. Again, can you compute the value of the fractional stress? I'm pretty sure you guys can do it, okay? And you also should be able to determine the maximum usually if the section has what's so called a double symmetry, maybe the I or Y flank section or rectangular section, this double symmetry usually has the maximum stress on the top and maximum stress on the bottom at the same value. However, if the section is a kind of T section or is a kind of C section, the section has only one symmetric axis, and by doing this, most of the time, the centroid of the section will be at this position. And then if you plot the fractional normal stress, the top will be less than the bottom. So by this way, the sigma max will be over here. So that's maybe another question that I asked you in the final examination. Okay. And then by considering the brittle material, such as the brittle material, such as the cast iron, the cast iron is will fail by brittle manner by the crack that occur in this section, and the brittle material will behave linear elastic to failure. So by doing this, we will use the fractional formula to compute the modulus of rupture, or I should say again, is equivalent to rupture stress. If the section is like this, can you prove for this equation? For sure. If you go to sigma equal to my over I, based upon this one, okay, the section is double symmetry. And based upon this, for the value of y, you will find sigma max y when y equal to c. It may be measured up or it may be measured out. Okay, so y equal to c. And then for the moment of inertia, you will have I equal to t times 2c cubed, t times 2c cubed, or by 12. That is going to be 8tc cubed over 12. And it can be cut 2 over 3tc cubed. Okay. And if you may recall the maximum moment for the 3-point loading, the maximum bending moment occur over here with PL over 4. So coming back to this point, it's going to be PL over 4. And then this is going to be C, okay? C, and then divided by 2 TC cubed divided by 2 TC cubed, and then 3 must be moved over here. So you got this one to be equal to this one is 3. And then 4 times 2 is going to be 8. And then it's going to be PL. And then it's going to divide by T. And C cubed, cut this one, is going to be C square, okay? If you put the force at the failure, this supposed to be the peak maximum. When it's failed, you will get the rupture stress occur in the cast iron. Okay, you may prove this one by this lecture. You may stop compute, stop this video and try to prove it by yourself. Again, if Ajahn Chieng, okay, the section to be this one, be this is to be, what is going to be the form of the rupture stress basis upon this? Okay, or if I change it to, let me just change this one to be P over 2. So it's going to has the same reaction. And then the chia over here is going to provide the maximum chia stress, the same value. And the one over here, if you may recall, is going to be PL over 6. Again, basis upon this, what is going to be sigma sub R, even though you go back to this one is T and the thickness is 2C. What is going to be the modulus of rupture equation for the brittle material? Okay, and then for the steel, for the steel, we do not consider the max modulus of rupture or the maximum rupture stress. For the steel, we determine the fractional yielding stress. The fractional yielding stress for the steel cannot compute directly from this curve. We will use 0.5 millimeter offset to determine the P offset. You may see this equation has the same form as the previous one, but we change from the P at rupture to the P by 0.5% offset. From the graph, we have this one as the load, and this one is the central deflection basis on our 3-point loading test. And this is in meter, this is in Newton, and this one is going to be 1 millimeter, right? This is 0, this is 2 millimeter. 0.5 millimeter supposed to be a point over here. By this method, you draw a line that's parallel to the first portion, and then you get the P offset. And for the second specimen over here, you may do the same thing, and you see the value of P offset is very close to the previous one. So this is a good thing of the 0.5 millimeter offset to taking care of some variable that may occur during the bending test of the specimen. And what you also need to consider is the slope. What is the slope K is for? If you may recall back under the 3-point loading that Ajahn just mentioned to you before, there is the maximum deflection occur in the half of its length, and this is going to be the V max, okay? And this is going to be the force P. The force P is here. The central deflection is still here. And from the mechanics of material, you go back to the deflection table, you will have the deflection to be P, the length cube over 48 EI. Rearrange this equation. This K is the P over deflection. Okay, by doing this, you may try to determine the value of modulus of elasticity. This one will be L cube over 48i, and then you get this one for p divided by v. That means if you know the slope, if you know this one the slope, you may compute the fractional modulus of elasticity as I did mention from the first slide of the bending test. Okay, so if I ask you guys, that is going to be close to 20 problems already. Can you compute the deflection that I mentioned about before? Or can you compute the fractional modulus of elasticity of the material that's used in this beam specimen? That is two way that may I may ask you. And from this table, as you may recall, it's going to be the deflection table. I took this picture. Sorry, this is going to be the beam. I took this picture from what? From the mechanics of Maclean textbook. This is the equation. Okay. And then again, from this equation, if you rearrange it properly, you may find the modulus of elasticity of the material. Okay. The limitation of the test, there is a lot of limitation for the bending test. First, the ratio of the length per depth. Okay. If the ratio is less than 10, the deflection of the beam may not produce by the moment only. This could be the deep beam. The deep beam, the deflection, okay, will be the function of moment and shear force and other factors. But this one has shear deformation in the consideration, and the section will warp like this, not in the linear elastic manner. And also, if you like to determine the proportional stress, the value that you get is may not correct, because the stress that occur on this beam going to reach maximum only on the top and bottom portion, and input beam is still less than the value. That's why the maximum stress by this test will have small yielding value compared to the tension test. And also, we have some another thing to avoid, such as that's for the avoid shear test of the wood specimen. If the wood is short, it may fail by the shear, maximum shear at the edge of the beam specimen. Okay, and you can prevent it if the beam is long enough. And also, like the ruler over here, if it's so thin and you bend it, you may see there are warping occur over here. So to avoid lateral warping or lateral buckling, the ratio between the D over B must be less than 15. This is no good. This is larger than 15. There are lateral buckling occurred. And we have the testing machine and procedure. As I tell you, we will have lab number 8 this week, and we will have lab number 9 next week. And in the last week, we will have the lab number 6 by Pipong Panot. Okay, that's going to involve compression, fracture, absorption test of the brick. Okay, let me take the telephone call first before, okay, and I will lecture after this. อาจารย์ครับสิทธิชัยแสงอาทิตย์จากมอสุรนรีครับอาจารย์เรื่องสมศครับอาจารย์ครับไม่อาจารย์นะฮะเรารู้จักอาจารย์ผ่านเป็นชื่อเคยทำงานกับอาจารย์ที่ไหนสักแห่งหนึ่งนะฮะเห็นชื่อปุ๊บเนี่ยเรียกว่าไนซ์ทันทีเลยว่าอาจารย์เนี่ยทำเอสเปกครับนี่สิทธิชัยก็เลยบอกเจ้าที่สมศว่าอาจารย์น่าจะเหมาะกว่าครับอาจารย์ครับขอบคุณอย่างยิ่งครับได้เรียนรู้จากอาจารย์ครับผมครับอาจารย์ครับสวัสดีครับโอเค I'm back sorry for that there is a call from associate professor from Nawamin Pillat University in Bangkok okay let me move to this portion in the lab P9 will lead you guys on the lab number 8 and lab number 9 and P. Pomanot will be on the lab number 6 when you go to the lab please check what type of specimen you are using I have some question in the final examination very simple such as in the lab number 8 what kind of material we use very simple right if you can answer me and I may ask you what laboratory number that we do the fractional test that is going to be 6, 8, 9 okay that's very simple and you should taking care of the defect check if there is some defect on the specimen you supposed to change your specimen to a better one and you just supposed to measure the dimension of the specimen carefully when you do the loading please load it carefully in order your guy can record the load and the deflection and you may also taking some note on for example localized yielding and how the specimen fail and I said the failure of the cast iron is going to be abrupt failure and the failure of the steel is going to be yielding okay and we determine the fractional modulus of elasticity if you may recall this E is going to be L cubed divided by 48 I and time the slope P over B okay the fractional modulus of elasticity that we take from this bending test is going to be close to the tension and compression test okay and there are some also note that you guys supposed to read it and understand it that is going to be the proportional limit that we get from this test maybe larger than what we consider like I explained to you guys the stress distribution on the specimen is not uniformly distributed so some of the portion still in the linear elastic when some point reach the yielding so the value that you get may be larger than what it should be and this is a rupture that I tell you before is occur in the brittle material such as the cast iron and then you guys need to compute for what for the modulus of rupture and again how you prove for the equation how can use the equation to determine the modulus of rupture and it's not really a modulus actually it is the rupture stress. Okay, and this kind of failure is occur by what? Is occur by the brittle material has low tensile strength. So when it's bent, the stress in the tension surface will open the micro crack, and the failure will occur rapidly. Okay, and there is many kind of failure for the timber. That is going to be like number 8 timber. Like number 9 is the steel and the cast iron. You supposed to take note on 5 of this, and I would like to focus on some of them. Is there are some tension failure, 4 of them. Okay, usually that's occur in the timber, and there is a compression failure in this one. Of these 5 beam, usually long beam. This is the mode of failure for the long beam. However, the last one is the F, is the horizontal crack. These 4 fail by moment, and moment. However, this one fail by the shear, and it's going to have the crack at the end of the specimen. And if you go back to chapter 7 of the mechanics of material, you will see this. Okay, and again, this is going to be F. Okay, this is the F, and this is going to be what? This is going to be A or C. Okay, this it may be A or C. Okay, I will give you the picture and ask you what kind of failure it is, or I may ask you, for this kind of failure, which picture represents it? Okay, and then for the yielding, it occur for the ductile material, and you will see for the ductile material, the material won't break it into 2 pieces. That is going to have the shape of failure like this. When you apply the force here, and this is going to be the reaction, and that is the yielding occur at this point. Why? Because this point is near the maximum bending moment point. So the stress over here is going to be maximum stress, and it's reached the yielding point, and it's going to develop what so-called the plastic kinks. Okay, that is due to the plastic moment or plastic kinks, and this called a failure of the ductile material already, because this failure has large deformation, so the structure cannot use as it is designed. And this is the picture, okay, of the specimen. You will see it next week. There are some factors that impact the fractional test, such as loading type, such as specimen dimension, and the stability of the testing specimen. And also, there is weighting. I won't take this one in the final examination because some of it is very hard to understand for undergraduate student. But you will study this thing again if you take the advanced mechanics of material, what so-called the local buckling, which is different from what we have in the chapter 19 of the mechanics of material. That is called the global buckling, and is based on what so-called the P critical, or is based on the Euler loop. But this one is more complex to compute. And why we study the local buckling in the graduate level, okay? And finally, I come to the fatigue. On the swimming engine structure, there are some structure such as bridge or the picture over here or the crane. You when you go to the F4 building, you can see the crane move and is subjected to repeated forces due to the vehicle. Okay, and that means this kind of structure subjected to life load that change in size and magnitude with respect to time, or is may called repeated loading or cyclic loading. And based upon this, you may see the load will change from tension and then to compression and then in tension and then to compression. You will do the lab 13 and use this kind of repeated load, what's so called the repeated load, to test the aluminum, and you will see the aluminum will fail under a certain of repeated load. And when we describe the fatigue, we consider a metal structure. So this is a kind of structure made by ductile material. And then this ductile material subjected to cyclic load. This cyclic load produce the stress and the strain that's lower than the yielding point for some period of time. By doing this, the material will get fatigue or the crack occur in the material due to the repeated load will get larger and larger, and finally the material fail by brittle or abrupt failure. Okay, we mistake that type material subjected to the heat repeated load, see the wing of the airplane, and the stress during the operation is less than the yielding, but for a certain time this material get fatigued and have the abrupt failure. Okay, this is the example of the failure of the steel bridge in the USA. Is occur on the I-35W bridge over the Mississippi River. That's occurred in the 2007. And by investigation of the officer, they found that that's caused by the fatigue. And that fatigue related to the corrosion, the steel structure when you use, okay, is subjected to weathering, such as rain, this is raining here, temperature from the sunlight, and the crack occur. When the crack occur, they subjected to the vehicle load. The beam have repeated, subjected to repeated load. So the crack go up larger and larger, and finally, the crack is large enough and the failure of the bridge occur like this. This is coming to our awareness of this kind of fatigue in recent year. You got to be aware of this. In the fatigue study, the load pattern is important. To describe the load pattern, there are some nomenclature or definition you guys supposed to know. First, maximum stress, okay? And the second, the minimum stress. Both of this sigma max and sigma min must be less than yielding stress, okay? And anyway, there is some one important thing is the mean stress. That is half of the maximum stress and minimum stress. So it's sigma max plus sigma min divided by 2. Okay? And also the space amplitude. That is going to be the 4 sigma max minus sigma min divided by 2. And the last one, space length is going to cover the length between sigma max and sigma min. We got to consider this because the stress that occur in the structure in the fatigue consideration must less than yielding stress. Okay, for example, it's going to be very easy if we have the wing of the beam when the beam the airplane fly over the air. Sometimes the wing get hit by the wind and have some vibration. And again, if we specify this picture of 10 megapascal, this is going to be sigma max, and this is going to be sigma min. And you can see both less than the yielding stress. And you got to determine the mean of this stresses. You may get this one to be 4 megapascal. And then if you determine sigma sub A, you just sigma max minus and minus 2 minus, and you get amplitude of 6 megapascal. And for the last one, stress length is going to be 2 times the stress amplitude. In the consideration of lab 13, you will be able to plot the SN curve. In the SN curve, the vertical axis going to be the stress. By our test, we will have the specimen, and our specimen will connect at the end to the mortar, and we will pull this one up with the force of P. And if you draw the free body diagram of this one, you will have V equal to P. And by doing this, you will have the moment equal to PL. When you increase the P, the moment increase. Okay, you mean you may put the stress as you wishes by changing the P. And then you put into the fatigue testing machine, the motor will spin our specimen. When it's bent, this one is in tension. When it's rotated, the tension is in compression like this. And then you record the number of loading cycle before the specimen fail. And you may see if the stress is large or if P is like 150 Newton, the number of cycle for the failure will be reduced. And you may see this graph put in the log scale to make the first portion of the SN diagram to be linear. Okay, if you have curve, you put log, that's going to be linear. Then this one is semi-log. And then this vertical is horizontal, is in the log cycle. If you reduce the force P, the stress reduce, the material can take more cycle of loading. And if you reduce, it's going to get last cycle until you take lower some point, what's so called over here. Over here called the endurance limit. If you load the structure less than endurance limit, the material in the structure can take an infinite number of cycles. That means the structure won't fail by fatigue. Okay. And for some specific number of cycles, if you plot like this, you will get the fatigue strength for a given cycle. And if you see for 100,000, the fatigue strength about 580. If you like to have 1 million cycle, you must to reduce the stress in your structure to be like 400 megapascal. You will have the specimen taking million cycle of loading. But if you select 400, which is lower than what so-called the endurance limit, your structure will take the loading in infinite number of cycle. Okay, again, you may see the endurance limit is about half of the ultimate stress. Actually, is in a range of 0.4 to 0.6. And in our civil engineering, if you trying to build a steel bridge, okay, you have sigma sub y to 2400, and you divide it by 2.0 factor of safety, and you design the bridge with sigma allowable of 1200 kilogram square meter. And then the endurance limit is about 0.4 to 0.6 of ultimate stress. Let's take the lower value, 0.4. That means the endurance limit for our structural steel is 2050, and the allowable less than the endurance limit. So most of the time, the steel bridge in our civil engineering application won't fail the fatigue, but we should aware about the corrosion crack that's occur in the slide I showed you before, because the crack may occur especially in the welding point and is subjected to corrosion with the repeated load. Everything will enhance the failure of the bridge can occur, even though in the basic theory it won't fail by fatigue basis upon this comparison. Okay, in non-ferrous material such as aluminum, there is no real endurance limit. Aluminum has the Fusdor endurance limit basis on what the function and the importance of the structure. If structure is important, you may use this value, okay, of the stress. That's maybe 100 megapascal in the design. That means the structure that's used less than 180 megapascal can take a large number of repeated load. However, if you design by a larger, for this one, 220 megapascal, you may see your structure has only 1 million time life. That means it's up to you guys to balance between what you decide and what you expect it to resist force, okay? And there are some limitation. I like you guys to study it and use this limitation in the lab number 13. When you make the discussion of the laboratory results. And the last one for this one, the aluminum specimen that we use is going to be like this. Again, the fatigue test, we are looking for the endurance limit, require a number of tests. That's a lot of number of tests. And the suggestion, you're supposed to start by testing the specimen with a higher stress to get the lower number of cycle, okay? And then you may reduce the stress for the following specimen, okay? And to reduce random error, at least 3 to 5 specimen must be tested. So the fatigue test will take a lot of time and expense. And most of the time we use this one in the typical taste of the material as you may test it in some big project, such as when you build a large bridge task subjected to the repeated load for the vehicle. And again, I'm asking you to calculate the mean stress, the stress strength, the alternating stress. So the total of question that I may ask you for this lecture can be as much as 20 or 25 problem. And again, that is the end of chapter 5.